Hello.
Today is IMPhD lectures. Our guest speaker is Tawanna Dillahunt from the University of Michigan, where she is an assistant professor in the School of Information. Tawanna, we've met a couple of times. We did an NSF workshop at Michigan. I'm aware of your work. We knew that there was overlap to the work that many of you are interested in, directly or indirectly at least, and I've been talking about her coming up to visit us for my lecture, so it's a great pleasure to finally see you here.
It's a pleasure
and
being
see you all here. Tawanna holds has an interesting background. On the one hand, with experience in the industry at Intel, for example, for a number of years. She also holds 3 patents based, I assume those are related to your industry experience.
IBM Research.
Yeah, right.
It's over 3 months and 93.
Exactly. And then she went into a more academic career with degrees in human computer interaction, computer science. But her PhD is in human computer interaction from Carnegie Mellon University. So it's a great pleasure to have you here. Thanks.
Thank you. Introduction. Thanks again, Johannes, for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be back. I actually applied to Michigan State when I was at Intel for the PhD, so I visited the campus before, and it's great to be back. So today I'll be talking to you about some research that I've done over the past 3 years, investigating opportunities for information and communication technologies to address the employment needs of underserved populations. I should also add that it's not necessarily the employment needs, it's also the employment barriers that exist. Most of my work is done in Detroit, and the work is motivated by the economic recession of 2013, which led to high unemployment rates, white flight, racially segregated neighborhoods, poverty, and as some of you know, the collapse in municipal infrastructure. And so my early research questions, this was as a postdoc at Michigan, I was trying to understand what are the strategies and resources that Detroiters use to get ahead. And by get ahead, this is, you know, what does it take, what do you think it takes to become economically mobile? What are the strategies that you're taking on, what types of resources are you using? And then what are some of the barriers you've encountered? The methods we use here were primarily interviews. But given my background in HCI, we also conducted workshops that were inspired by participatory design. So in order to answer this last question, we wanted to understand what role that they felt technology could play in addressing these barriers. So that's the motivation for the early research. And basically what came out of the early research was that people felt the need to connect to others. So people lacked access to strong networks. If you think about Detroit, what they explained to us was that if you could afford to leave, then you left, and those of us who are still here or are unemployed and still trying to figure out how to make it. So you can imagine being in a network where others around you are also unemployed, and you ask yourself the question, well, who am I going to turn to? Who do we turn to? So they felt that in order to get ahead, they needed to access resources that were outside of the community. There are also other things that came up, education, access to education, free education, affordable education, and then also just understanding what skills were needed to find jobs. But the key theme that came out of this work, earlier work, was networks. And so this led to the next research question, which I'll talk to you about, which basically all the research that I talked to you about tries to explore. And this is, how can we use ICTs to foster connections and social capital among individuals and groups that have little to no social capital. And so today I'll talk to you about 3 studies. The first was a feasibility study trying to understand whether the sharing economy could work in underserved populations. The second study is ReviewMe, which is an application that we developed ourselves to connect job seekers with people who were employed. And then the third study is a study that we've done to try to onboard people to Uber to address some of the transportation issues that exist in Detroit in order to access jobs. And so let me just define, by underserved, what I mean is low income, people from low SES areas, limited education, and we had a more formal term for underserved, but I'm just going to use underserved because the majority of people are lower income and have limited education. So why did we start by looking at the sharing economy? First of all, how many of you are familiar with the term sharing economy? Okay. Oh, well, all of you. So Uber, Lyft, Airbnb is probably the most popular application of it. But the sharing economy offers, we know, the potential to meet people. So people or can build social capital and have. So if you're an Uber driver, we hear stories of drivers meeting their riders and exchanging, you know, networking in the car, essentially. Of course, there are financial opportunities for workers, so there's a means for employment. You also have an opportunity to build your skills, though this, I feel like this is something that hasn't been exploited as much as it should, and we'll talk about that. The fact that there's sharing involved, there's usually lower prices for consumers, and then it's environmentally sustainable. So I come from a background in which my PhD work was all about saving energy. So this was interesting. And so the research goals in this first study were really to understand, again, if the sharing economy is feasible, what are the barriers to entering the sharing economy for these populations, what are opportunities, and then again, more of a focused question about the technology platforms themselves, or are these applications possible solutions to unemployment, or in what ways could they be solutions to employment? And before we began this study, I turned to the literature. This is Botsman and Rogers. She has a book out on, this is called What's Mine is Yours. And in this book, she defines four principles that are required in order for the sharing economy to be successful, or the collaborative economy to be successful. And the first principle, I'm sure all of you know, is that it requires trust between strangers. Right? If I'm going to allow someone in my car, I should have some level of trust, or if I'm going to host my condo off for Airbnb, then I need to have some level of trust that people are not going to, you know, crash my place or ruin my place. Idling incapacity has to do with underutilized resources. So I drove here from Ann Arbor by myself. I had four seats that I could have, you know, shared with someone else. So in order to participate, you need to have unused or underutilized resources. And then critical mass has to do with conformity to the norm. There need to be enough people participating in the market so that others feel like they can come on board and participate as well. So this is needed for social influence, social conformity. And then the last principle is belief in the commons. And this essentially means that by participating in the sharing economy as either a producer or consumer, it means that I believe that I'm adding some value to the community. So using these principles, we conducted another workshop session, again, inspired by participatory design. We conducted a set of surveys, a learning session, which I'll give you detail about a bit later, and then a design and innovation session. We recruited active job seekers, and we defined active job seekers as people who have been actively looking for jobs in the past 6 months. We recruited from unemployment agencies. Some of you may have heard of Michigan Works, Craigslist, barbershops, and hair salons. Barbershops and hair salons are a really good place to recruit. The beauticians know, they interact with the community, they know a lot of people, so they can put those ads up in contact. These sessions lasted about 3 hours. We compensated participants $30. We also provided food and learning materials after the session. And we had 20 participants in the session. So we basically split these into two sessions. So surveys, we collected basic demographic information. We wanted to know how long people had been unemployed or actively looking for jobs. We also wanted to baseline what people knew about the sharing economy. Were they familiar with applications of the sharing economy already? We had a learning session. So you can imagine, you know, a group like this, we have, you know, multiple, not really a workstation, but just tables. So we had people, they didn't know each other, sit at groups of 3 to 4, and then we handed out these blank workshop packets. No one knew what was inside the packets. But what was inside the packets were application descriptions for four instances of the sharing economy. And we used these based on what was available in Detroit or what we heard would be available. For example, TaskRabbit didn't deploy in Detroit, but at the time, TaskRabbit said we'll be in Detroit, you know, soon. So we went with TaskRabbit. So Lyft is a real-time ride-sharing service. I'm sure you have you all heard of Lyft? Okay. How many of you have used Lyft or Uber? All right. So Airbnb, which allows you to share your home. TaskRabbit, which is a platform that allows people to post tasks. So if I need to have my walls painted, for example, I'll post it on TaskRabbit, and instead of hiring a professional company to paint the walls, I can hire a neighbor, you know, someone in my neighborhood to do it. So you can sign up as someone with jobs or someone who's looking for jobs. And then Neighbor Goods, which is somewhat like Craigslist Free. It's a platform that facilitates sharing and selling of unused goods or, you know, underutilized assets. And so participants read about, in each group, they read about their applications. We spent some time to make sure they really understood what each application did, and we answered questions if necessary. We had response sheets, which basically included questions to get back at this, at these four principles that were required. So we had response sheets for individuals in each group, and then once they finished the individual answering of the questions, then we asked them to fill out another response sheet for the group. This was because we're recruiting in different parts of Detroit, and some neighborhoods, the neighborhoods are quite different, so we wanted to kind of get at different perspectives. So some questions, just sample questions from the response sheets. One question to get at trust between strangers was, would you feel comfortable working as a Lyft driver, driving other people around? And would you feel comfortable hiring a Lyft driver? Would you feel comfortable driving with, you know, this? We had personas as well. Would you feel comfortable, you know, driving this person? Questions related to idling capacity had to do with understanding if people had underutilized resources. So for Neighbor Goods, if you were to use Neighbor Goods, what types of items would you share? And what types of items would you borrow? So participants had to list out these items, so we have an understanding of what kinds of items they would be willing to borrow. And after that session, we made sure that people were, you know, understanding the applications and had completed all the response sheets. And we had what we call a design and innovation session. So a learning session. Basically, people talked with their individual groups, but then they chose one representative from the group to talk to everyone. So, and then everyone was allowed to participate. So you can imagine the group talking about Lyft, explaining the conversation they had in their individual groups, and then others coming in and commenting, like, oh, you know, I think, you know, Lyft would, you know, work well, you know, in this area, maybe not this area. So we got a chance to hear perspectives from all group members. So we took a break after the learning session, and we went to, so you see the report up, and then we went to the design and innovation session. And usually in these types of sessions, we bring in aspects of technology. And let me start by saying that before we started, I defined terms so that everyone was on common ground. So in this context, if you say application, they think job applications right away. So we had to define applications. We actually allow them to define technology. We ask them what is their perception of technology. So that was kind of a grounding session. And in the design and innovation session, we asked participants, if you could talk to the developers of Airbnb, Neighbor Goods, Lyft, and TaskRabbit, what would you tell them to design or build for you based on your current employment situation? So we allow them to, you know, say, look, you're hiring someone. What would you have the developers build for you? And also for context, in our learning session, everyone had a role that they played, and the roles kind of came from tech. So you're a client, you're evaluation lead, for example. This was so that people could participate and then also know what these roles were in real life. So once we got to this session, people knew what developers were. So the data that was collected, again, we had our surveys, our response sheets. Each session, each individual session or group session was recorded, so was the full session. We had those professionally transcribed. And now to answer our questions, is the sharing economy feasible for underserved populations? What are the barriers? What are the opportunities? We found that there was some promise of the sharing economy. The first thing was that people were familiar with some of these applications. Lyft and Uber, people had heard about, and then Airbnb, a couple people had heard about that. We found that there was all except one principle met, which was critical mass, and then we were able to identify new principles that Bossman and Rogers didn't talk about in their original framework.
Can I just ask you a question, clarification?
Mm-hmm.
How did you establish that critical mass was not met? Because there's probably others outside of the particular group.
Right. So we'll talk about it.
Okay.
At least for this population, mm-hmm. we know that critical mass may be an issue for, mm-hmm. for this population. Even though, and another thing is, people had heard about these applications, but they hadn't used them themselves. And we'll talk about that as a barrier. So in terms of critical mass, we're going to talk to Josh about this at breakfast, is that participants wanted to be self-sufficient. We found that participants were willing to lend, they were willing to help others, but they weren't open to receiving help or borrowing from others. And this was something that we found, but I didn't quite understand it. And so what I do in my research is I present results back to the organizations that we work with, nonprofit organizations. And what they explained to me was that, hey, you're talking to a group that have, deep-rooted desire for independence to fulfill the American dream. So people are growing up and being told that, everyone should have their own home, white picket fence, 2.5 kids. And then all of a sudden, someone's coming in and saying, sharing economy, we should all share. So that's kind of it's a model that's new that it may take some time to really get used to. So what we say is this could lead to limited participation and social influence needed for sharing economy applications to thrive in these communities. We also identified new principles. The first one is collective efficacy. This really came from the neighbor goods group. The way I like to describe collective efficacy is, I'm from the South, I'm from North Carolina, and as a kid, I would go outside and play, and if I did something wrong, then before I could even get in the house, the neighbors had already told my parents what I had done. I lived in an area that was high in collective efficacy, and people talk about, maybe this works in your neighborhood, but it won't work in mine, because in my neighborhood, people come and go. Right, you have to have some length of time, you have to have communities that have been together for years and years in order to establish this collective efficacy. And so that was something that came up in our discussion. We also saw aspects of platform distrust. Those who had Lyft said, as a driver, if I'm going to drive for Lyft, I have to go through these background checks. And we included all of these details in the descriptions. Said, if I have to go through a background check as a driver, then my rider should have to go through a background check too, right? So that lack of two-way screening was problematic for some. Payment methods, this is something that's not new in the literature. People didn't trust providing, their credit cards to these platforms. And then there were also misconceptions about reputation systems. So, they said, I'll just read the quote. I don't know what I think about that, because I know people, and if they don't know you, they aren't too receptive. You have to be referred by somebody. So in a reputation system where you see others ranking, it could be anything that they're ranking. It could be ranking you. But you don't know the people who are providing the rankings, right? And they say, if I don't know who's providing the ranking, then I can't trust that. It needs to be someone that I know that, gives that ranking. So there were some misconceptions about reputation systems, distrust for these reputation systems. And then those in the neighbor goods group brought this up, is that if we're going to exchange things with others, then it needs to happen in a safe place. I don't want a stranger coming to my door. I don't want to go to a stranger's house. But we can go to a police station, or the police department, or a fire station in order to conduct the exchange. And what I later saw, after this session, a few months later, I saw that Washtenaw County had designated the sheriff's office as kind of a Craigslist transaction safety zone. And this is exactly what people were asking for. This is a billboard someone sent to me about, you know, Craigslist, avoid being robbed. So this exchange, you know, people were, they didn't trust that. They said, we need to do it in the same place. Is there any questions so far? You guys are good. Alright, so the next question was, are applications of the sharing economy possible solutions to employment, unemployment, or employment? And people did see employment opportunities on the platforms, but I'll say up front that they didn't view these platforms as something that I would do permanently. I'm not going to participate in the platform as a Uber driver for the rest of my life, but I think this can serve as kind of a stepping stone. So they talked about applications could strengthen offline relationships, again, going back to this fostering social capital. But through skills and services, bartering, they saw it as a platform to advertise their skills within the community, and then also share employment opportunities with others. So it's like, if I hear about this job, you know, through TaskRabbit, and I can't do it, maybe I'll go over here and tell my friend who's unemployed that they can do it. And what really came out is that they could potentially have connections to hiring professionals. So if I get a job on TaskRabbit and I'm painting your home and I do a great job, then maybe you'll provide a reference to me, or maybe you know someone who's hiring full time that you can make that connection to me for. This is really where they saw the opportunities for employment through these platforms. In terms of employment barriers, now these barriers came out through the innovation session. When we were asking, you know, what could a developer do for you in order to help you in your current situation? And people talked about getting the interviews can be problematic. You have a child, you don't have access to child care, or if you don't have reliable transportation, you can't get to your job or the job they interview on time. Other barriers that they talked about was that, you know, some people said they can land interviews, but they never hear back from employers. Others said, well, we upload our resumes or we send in our resumes and we never hear back from employers. So they said if there was an app that could, you know, tell us why, you know, no one looked at our resume or tell us why we didn't get the job based on the interview, then I would want that application. If someone could do that for me, then I would use it. And then we also saw that participants needed direction in terms of employment. Some people asked, you know, what opportunities are available and then what skills do we need in order to get these opportunities that are available. And then again, better connections to employers came out. So we're still seeing this, how do we connect to the people with resources? So based on the results of basically that key finding, you know, you landed interviews but you never heard back from employers, or you submitted your resume and you never heard back, we developed an application called Review Me. We started off by allowing people to upload their resumes. And then we sought volunteers, and the volunteers would basically give them feedback on the resume that they uploaded. But before I go into Review Me, do you guys have any questions about the application?
So Review Me is kind of like Yelp for people, but for jobs instead of...
It's not really a Yelp where they're evaluating the existing jobs or existing job conditions. It's more of a place for them to connect, to get feedback from others who are likely employed or work in a position that could, you know, instead of going to a job center. Now, I will say some people avoided job centers because job centers ask for social security numbers, and you know, but we can talk about that later.
Did anybody mention concerns about the potential income that they could achieve from these types of jobs? Because I mean, you probably know that there's JP Morgan study that looks at bank transactions, which are quite detailed, and what they found is that the income is actually very incremental in most people.
At this level, no one's thinking about income.
Yeah.
Everyone's thinking about getting a job, landing a position, because some income for some is, you know, better than nothing. But I can talk, we'll kind of talk about this later, with people having to take the buses to the suburbs for low-paying jobs, which in some cases is not really worth it. So no one was at that level. They just felt that they needed to land something, if only to get skills that they needed to get something else. Right. So not yet.
So did participants perceive this kind of job as a temporary job? Or?
Yeah, they view these as stepping stones. And also for the task rabbit, you know, trying to get at like what skills could be available, we asked what kinds of jobs, you know, would you do, what kinds of jobs would you want to have done? And some people said, you know, I have skills, I could help people move, I was a mover, you know, these are things that I could offer. But for the most part, they saw this as kind of as a stepping stone, not a full-time. They didn't view them as a full-time job. And this isn't anything we talked about. They just, you know, they just didn't perceive it as full-time.
Can you comment a little bit on the social demographics of your group?
Yeah, so the majority were African-American. We had, I think I talked to you about this at lunch in this session, the advertisement got to a halfway house. So we had some people who were ex-felons. And probably even this distribution of male, female, I think the ages were 25 to 62, or 25 to 60 for this. All the age groups for my studies are pretty much the same, young and old. Any other factors in social demographics?
Yeah, in line with that question, actually, I wanted to know what was the experience of using information and technology for that group? Because in order to find the opportunity, you have to have some basic knowledge
yes.
of IT itself.
No, this is a great point that I'll get to in reviewing me. But with this particular group, we did do a technology assessment. And so they, you know, they listed out like Facebook. They use, you know, Facebook, not for jobs, but to connect with friends. They used, I think it's like Monster, some of these job sites where you can search. So we didn't perceive that they were serious tech issues, like this didn't come out of the session, but I'll tell you in review me where it did come out. And another thing is, you know, this was Detroit, the review me application was Southeast Michigan, so not quite Detroit, but in these areas and at libraries. And you see, this is something I'm working on now, just trying to understand the variations in tech literacy. So review me, we built this application based on it was a user, we followed a user-centered design process. I'll talk to you about that. But we had this application, and we wanted to understand the limitations of the application under contextual factors, which is kind of what I'm getting at. And what, you know, under what contextual factors do these limitations exist? And what user UX design principles best support these limitations? And as I mentioned, we followed a user-centered design process. We met with HR representatives, we have contact with Michigan Works and other job centers. We visited, you know, public libraries to you know, trying to follow how people are searching for jobs. We even participated in an employment intake process to understand what that was about. So one thing is we were working with, I had an undergraduate student with me that summer. She's really young and she went to these centers, and I think she just had that face you just don't say, you can't say no to. So they're like, of course you could come into Michigan Works, and if this is for your study, we'll help you out, right? And, you know, she was able to conduct interviews with job seekers in the center. And what I'll tell you later is that when my master's student and I went, they told us no. So we had to recruit outside the center. And I think there's a difference between the people in the center and the people in the library or outside the center. There are some differences regarding digital literacy. So this is, you know, what Review Me looks like. Basically, this page here is a job seeker. They've updated their resume. They provided a job description of what it is that they want to do. What we heard from the HR representative is in order to have a strong resume, you need to show how your resume can fit the job that you're looking for. And then this is how the volunteers evaluated that application. It was based on the job description. So they had different sections to give feedback on. So you give overall feedback on the app, formatting issues, you know, education section. And so, you know, participants would log in as either or register as either a volunteer or a job seeker and then go through this process. And just to make sure we didn't have kinks, we deployed Review Me to university students, the career centers, really outside of the career centers because they didn't allow us in, and then the public libraries. And what I'll tell you is that university students loved Review Me. They loved the honest feedback that that they got? I guess there's a point in your career where you talk to your friends and they're afraid to hurt your feelings, so everything looks good. So they felt like getting feedback from people they don't know is, they felt like they were receiving honest feedback. Everyone said that they prefer expert reviewers. They couldn't really gauge the level of expertise from the feedback that they were getting. And then the barrier for university students is that there were slow response times for some resumes, given their educational background. So it takes time to find volunteers for certain majors. But what's really interesting are the results we got from the target population, because as Rishon and I are outside of Michigan Works, they won't allow us to come in. We're telling them about about ReviewMe and giving them the website. And they were like, well, I don't really have access to my digital resume. I saved it on the computer in Michigan Works, but they reformatted everything, and so I lost it. Or I had it on a thumb drive, but I lost the thumb drive, or it was stolen, right? So they didn't have access to the digital resume. They didn't quite understand, because we tried to explain, oh, have you ever emailed it to someone? So if you emailed it to someone, you can look in your sample. They didn't really understand that. So very few people had access to digital resumes, but some people had physical copies. Some people were handing us their resumes. And I'll later tell you that we added a feature so you could take a picture and upload it. Once we were inside of the library to walk people through the registration process, we saw that email addresses and passwords weren't readily available. We saw people go and try to retrieve their passwords. And this was done via like SMS, basically. So they would check their phones. And then registration was also difficult, not just because of low digital literacy, but also because of low reading literacy. This is what we're seeing seeing at public libraries. And I think the key takeaway and concern that we had from this is that employers are requiring more people to upload these digital copies of resumes, more and more, because it's cheaper for employers to do it that way. But not just employers. I mean, we're talking about access to healthcare. We're talking about finding affordable housing, and these populations are going to continue to be left behind without some level of change. So we've since updated ReviewMe, but we haven't redeployed it yet because we still need to work through some issues. And this is, the contribution that we've made to the design community is having these principles. The first is compatibility. So we've accepted photograph images of resumes if people carry the physical form. Smartphones, most people had smartphones with a camera. Practicality, again, allow individuals to submit their resumes offline to account for late technology adopters. Again, allow participants to register with familiar accounts. So SMS, not really password, but maybe a couple questions. If it's uploading resumes, I don't know if security is that big of a concern. So if it's not, then maybe something like this is okay. And then, direct support. Some people are just going to require handholding. So before I move on, I'll take questions.
Was there any target volunteer?
So we're working with an HR representative who provided us with some volunteers, but then some students from.
I mean, if you really deploying that, for example, in the market, not as.
In the market. So we've thought about this. This is so Dave just met with me briefly. We've thought about this. One thing about, let's say, LinkedIn. I read on LinkedIn that people want to volunteer more. They want to have volunteer experiences. The times that they volunteer, they want to add that to their resume. And some people they haven't had an opportunity to volunteer. So we've thought about having, resume reviews, opportunities for people to volunteer. And then Quicken Loans has a program for their employees where they want them to give back so many hours per month. So that's another source if we were to deploy it broadly. So these are things that we've been thinking about. That's a good question. Any other questions? So the next study that I'll talk to you about really has to do with addressing the transportation barrier, but also to follow on to this feasibility study. So our initial study was kind of hypothetical. You know, they had the applications, but this is, you know, real onboarding of Uber, one of the real-time ride sharing services. So many of you, I'm sure, have read the news that Detroit has reduced and eliminated bus services. 40% of Detroiters don't have cars, no regular access to cars. And then among the lower-earning Detroit areas, more than 10,000 residents travel each day to the suburbs for low-paying jobs, right? And we've talked to training centers who say that people are basically losing money by paying for the bus to, you know, get very low-wage jobs. So the research questions, again, what are the digital sharing economy's feasibility requirements for our target population? Especially sought out people who lived in transportation scarce environments. Not all of Detroit is transportation scarce, but there are certain areas that are really bad. How do these individuals describe their experiences using a real-time ride-sharing service? And then what barriers do people face in this onboarding process? And so we went in based on our prior studies expecting some barriers. But we wanted to evaluate these requirements. Belief in the commons based on our past research, we thought this would be met in this current study. Idling capacity, we didn't see that as being a problem. Trust between strangers, we didn't think so, but we had somewhat just because people before talked about, well, it depends on where you live, it depends on your neighborhood. Critical mass, based on our prior study, we said no. Collective efficacy, which is, again, coming from the prior study, no. And then trust in the platform, no. But we eliminated some of these barriers. So trust in the platform at this point has to do with providing access to credit cards. And we used Uber at the time because Uber has this, they had a business account. So we could bring our participants in as employees. And so we could manage, you know, how much they were spending. I provided like our own credit cards, and we allocated a certain amount of money for participants. So our participants didn't need to have a credit card to participate. So we were eliminating that. And then we also, we handheld those people who needed it to where we were with them. We installed the application, helped them register, that kind of thing. But in terms of what we expected in terms of employment enhancing opportunities or experiences kind of goes back to a sense of serendipitous connections, right? This was Amanda's story. Amanda's an Uber driver, but she talks about how she's a networker in her job. And we talked about drivers exchanging their cars. A question was, well, can passengers benefit in the same way? So this is, you know, what we were expecting. And then again, the expected barriers, I talked about it. We addressed limited access to credit cards, limited trust in the system. Again, we kind of help walk them through the process. You know, access and digital literacy, we expected, but again, we tried to onboard to reduce that. And we provided, you know, direct support. So the methods we used, we had a pre-screening survey to make sure that people were coming from transportation scarce areas. I'll tell you later about that process. We onboarded participants to Uber Business. Lyft now has it, but Lyft didn't back then. And we provided them with a $75 credit to use the service. We asked participants while they were riding to keep a diary, or they could also text messages. But we wanted them to tell us where they were going, what the ride was like. Did they talk to their driver? If so, what did they talk about? And then the last question was, you know, did you learn something new? What, you know, if you learned something new, what did you learn? And then we concluded the study with a one-hour semi-structured interview and a post survey. So recruitment methods, we went to walkscore.com to confirm vulnerability scores, and we identified 10 zip codes to prioritize. We also identified low SES areas based on zip codes and using citydata.com. And so we went to our kind of our community partners, stakeholders, and asked them to help us to recruit from these areas. So again, we recruited both online and offline, reputational case sampling, which is us going to our partners and asking them to help us with recruitment, and then snowball sampling. And then, of course, going to barbershops and hair salons in those zip codes. So here we work with the Guidance Center, which is a training organization in River Rouge. And then FII.org is basically an organization that helps communities build like, social support, strengthen the communities, and they were on board. So again, the data we had included the journals, so participants' diary entries. Uber, since we had the business account, we had access to individual start endpoints. So we had like how long was the ride? And then at this point, Uber had surge prices. How many of you are familiar with surge? Okay, so they've hidden it now. They have it, but they've hidden it. So we were able to capture their decisions to accept surge and then what the multipliers were. Again, we had our interviews transcribed. And then we made our own observations during the recruitment process. We had 13 participants, ages 20 to 52, income less than $20,000 a year. So we took a hybrid coding approach to analyzing the interviews. We went back to Bossman and Rogers principles as well as the principles we had identified before to understand feasibility. And we also took on an open coding process to see new codes as they emerged. Interviews lasted anywhere from 30 to 60 minutes. We had 160 codes total, 31 inquiry, and then 129 new codes to emerge. So where do people go? People took trips to work, job interviews, medical appointments, and went grocery shopping. They visited family and on the other side of Detroit. And then there was one person who said, yeah, I went to the movies. So to address the research question, just to remind you, these are the principles. The first four are from Bossman. The second two are the ones that we came up with in our first study. And in terms of belief in the commons, what's interesting is that we weren't able to recruit from barbershops or hair salons. It was really our nonprofits that we worked with that helped us with the recruiting. And we believe that this is so because they saw the value that providing transportation would have to the community members, especially the organization that helped people with the job training. So once they helped us to you know, bring people on board, then we saw snowball sampling from those members. And just to give you some insight from our participants, they're the ones that helped us, you know, the snowball sampling. They referred others. Vet says that, you know, I've known people that have actually lost their jobs due to the public transportation failure. And, you know, she saw Uber as very reliable. And, you know, of course, if someone's going to lose a job or transportation, she's trying to help people out. So she sees the value that it would provide to a community. Day-Day said that I would recommend Uber to a lot of people who really need it, mainly women with kids. I'm just doing my part by doing it word of mouth. Day-Day talked about seeing single moms going to buses with the strollers and just having a hard time. And so his target was, you know, single moms. Again, there's some value to the community that the service could provide. In terms of trust in the platform, we saw a lack of transparency of the company, but also in how surge pricing works. And our participants raised this in interviews, but also in our attempts to recruit. And then even in our offline recruiting efforts, we saw what people talked about, past issues around monetary transactions, which I'll talk about here. So again, we're recruiting from barbershops and hair salons, and as we were talking to the shop owner about our study, someone overheard and said, you know, I had an Uber charge on my credit card, and I've never used the service. Right? So obviously someone else took, you know, maybe a kid borrowed the card. And she had no idea how to remove this charge from her credit card, because Uber was nowhere to be found. And so we provided some level of technical support. I helped her, you know, take the charge off. I don't work for Uber. Uber's not paying us for the study. But someone overheard that, and they were like, where is Uber located? Right? And then there's this chatter around the salon about, you know, see, that's why I don't want to use, you know, these services because they don't exist, basically. And someone said, you know, I hate the cabs, but I trust the cabs because if something goes wrong, I know where the taxi stand is, and I can go there to, you know, get my money back. So there are some issues around, you know, dealing with platforms that you can't see, right? There's no real way. In terms of surge pricing, Acorn, you know, she actually showed us in an interview. She said, surge could be higher, it could be lower, or it could have ended. Yeah, now you see what I'm talking about. And there's two cars together, so I don't understand why it's surging. So she was showing us, it's like, she looked at it as a supply demand. So if there are two cars, you know, she's one person who needs a ride, why is there surge? So she had no idea how surge worked. It could have been the weather, it could have been the time of day. So this is, you know, what we heard. Acorn actually said that she thinks she can stop surge from working. She says, I'll turn my phone off, and I'll turn it on, and then surge will be gone. And I think, you know, this is why. So in terms of critical mass, you know, again, we were unable to recruit participants due to low digital literacy and discomfort with technology. So, I mean, our study is biased because those who did join are the ones who felt comfortable using the technology. But there were people we tried to recruit that turned us away, not just because they didn't know this thing existed, but because they said, well, I don't really feel comfortable hailing a ride through my phone. Someone else had, actually a few people had issues around not having a steady data plan on their phone. So they said, you know, I have Wi-Fi at home, and I trust being able to call Uber from home, but if I go to the grocery store, then how am I going to get back? And because of that, I said, you know, I don't know. She's like, well, you know, I don't feel comfortable with that, so I'm not going to join. And then, as I mentioned, we served as a bridge between Uber and potential participants because we were, you know, helping them to reduce these, you know, remove the charges and kind of answering these types of questions. So additional requirements that came out of the study and are consistent with past literature are economic benefits. So we can't really comment on economic benefits because we paid, you know, we were providing services, but they did give us insight in terms of Uber being cheaper than the taxi cabs. they said that they're the same prices as jitney cabs. How many of you are familiar with the term jitney? So jitney is just an unregulated cab company. Most of the time, you know jitney drivers through word of mouth. Sometimes the grocery stores has like a dedicated driver for the store. It's unregulated, but I don't think people go after jitney drivers, right? So they said that it's the same price as jitney cabs, which are cheaper, but they felt safer because, first of all, jitney cabs only accept cash, and then secondly, people don't trust every jitney driver, again, unless you have someone who told you that this jitney cab is okay. So they didn't necessarily trust the jitney cabs. And jitney cabs, to be quite honest with you, they don't have consistent prices, right? So I can ask, you know, oh, $5, you can ask, say, $25, right? It's still cheaper than a taxi cab. So the shortcomings, again, we pay for the service, so it's really hard to assess. But we did try to contact our participants like 3 months after the study to figure out if they were still using the service. And we only had 13 people, but of those 13, we were able to contact 7, and only one person was still using the service. So we think perhaps it's probably too expensive, or, you know, again, we were providing our own credit cards. People may not feel comfortable giving their credit card information. So the second question is, how do these individuals describe their experience using a service? Everyone loves the fact that Uber tells you where the drivers are, right? They know it's coming, so that's reliable. That's better than a bus that we don't know if it's going to come at all. Frog says, you know, that's what I like because you can see them coming to you. I don't want to make them wait any extra time because I know their time is money. And some passengers really appreciated being able to sit in their homes if it's cold outside or if it's raining, you know, for the car to come and then they can go outside. But another thing that came out of the study was the rich social interactions and common courtesy between riders and drivers. So our passengers talked about drivers helping them with groceries. You'll see a couple quotes here. A says that we were talking about the growth in the city, like how the youth are and how things change when I was riding with Sam. He was telling me what certain businesses used to be that I didn't even know about. And in our interview with Sam, he was like, yeah, my Uber driver was almost like a historian, right? And he said, you know, I had to fact check and make sure he wasn't lying to me. I was checking this stuff, what used to, you know, exist in this place in Detroit. But he was accurate. So, you know, that was an exchange that Ace had. Dale is another case that stands out because Dale, he as a child had been shot, and he had delayed like speech, slurred his speech. And Dale says, he asked me when he took me to Target, did I work there? And I told him that I was trying to get a job there. And he said if I had my license, that Wayne County downtown was doing hiring for part-time cleanup janitorial stuff. Most of them, he's referring to the drivers, were nice, but he called out Mr. Wayne, made me feel comfortable, and talked to me and gave me encouragement not to stop looking for work. So Dale is someone who's actively looking for jobs. He's getting the encouragement from his Uber driver, not only to continue looking for work, but also some leads as to where he may be able to find work. So there are lots of examples of those rich social interactions that we're analyzing. We're conducting a second level analysis, and we're using social capital theory and also cultural capital theory as a framework to code this data. Because there are aspects of cultural capital that people learn, Ace learned what classical music sounded like. He said, I'd never heard classical music before. I thought it was jazz until I saw on the station that it was classical. And hey, it relaxed me kind of. So there's a lot of data that still needs to be analyzed in terms of social interaction. And then the third question has to do with the barriers that these groups faced in using real-time ride-sharing services. Additional barriers, there were passengers who had mobility issues. Acorn has a walker. She says, sometimes I think, God, can that walker fit in that vehicle? But we've gone into every vehicle, even if it has to go across the seat, the rear seat, so just stuff like that. That way, when a similar vehicle is showing up, I know how to do it. So she talked about some anxiety that she had because she had a walker, and she just wasn't sure if it could. But she said it fit most of the time, but she still had that worry. So she was saying it'd be nice to know, you know, what size vehicle it is or if it could accommodate. So to summarize findings and requirements to go back to this framework, belief in the commons, we say yes to some extent, but primarily through these nonprofit organizations, the people that we try to recruit outside of those. I don't know if it's a matter of they don't see the value or they just don't trust the brand so much, so they haven't gotten to the point of thinking about it in that way. Trust between strangers. Everyone said, we had a question in our interview about this. Everyone said they trusted their driver, but then you have a couple people who say, well, I did take a screenshot of my driver's picture and I emailed it to my, or I texted it to my family member, just in case, right? So people trust it, but then just in case they do these things. Critical mass, no collective efficacy, this really didn't come up as much. Trust in the platform we have limited because those that we weren't able to recruit didn't trust the platform, but those who we recruited were okay. Again, we provided credit card information. Accessibility we have limited, but I know Lyft is working on this problem alone. And then economic benefits, we say uncertain but not likely. And again, we propose design suggestions for real-time ride-sharing systems, and then also we try to propose broader design suggestions for the sharing economy, for sharing economy applications. So the first thing is, you know, work on improving platform trust, work to increase brand trust, visibility, and then transparency in how the system works. I think in order to reach critical mass, you could, you know, in this case, leverage belief in the commons. So if you have enough nonprofits or enough people or organizations kind of see the value in these real-time ride-sharing services, then perhaps it could lead to increased uptake. This is something we're exploring right now. And we're not just looking at real-time ride-sharing services. We're looking at like Zipcar, for example, other transportation models. I broadly say design for inclusivity. This is part of my mantra. But again, you have a low barrier of entry for those that have limited digital literacy and limited internet access. You also want to allow for alternative payment mechanisms. So everyone doesn't have a credit card. So what other forms of payment could you accept? And I actually propose like a public kiosk as a one size, you know, fits or one kind of a one solution that could address these issues. The first thing is that a public kiosk would raise visibility. It add accountability. So if you imagine a public kiosk for a real-time ride-sharing service in a barbershop, and you know that in order to get to the barbershop or a hair salon, they had to talk to the owners, right, or a grocery store, but they had to, you know, get someone to vouch for them to be there. It could also support belief in the commons. In terms of inclusivity, instead of requiring the data plan, you know now if you go to, a grocery store or wherever, it could be a medical appointment facility, that there will be internet access. And then it allows for alternative payments. But another thing I don't mention here is that those with low digital literacy or low self-efficacy to use these tools, when you see other people in public using them, I think it raises some confidence to use them. And even if you can't use them, you know you have people around you that could help. So I'm looking at models of tech where you make it visible, like how the tech is, could be used or is used. So in summary, in terms of ICTs and supporting employment, participants needed better connections to employers or those in hiring positions. They need feedback from employers. Why don't we get the jobs? And then some direction in terms of employment. Where can we go in order to find jobs that in which I could use my skills? And these are also projects that we have. We're working on other tools that can address some of these issues. We've also identified requirements, ICT requirements to support employment, compatibility, practicality, relying on the things that are familiar or accessible to people, and then just providing direct support if needed. So with that, I'll summarize by saying that our research helps to understand the employment needs of underserved populations. Our research helps to understand many of the constraints that people face. And then future research, again, will contribute tools to mitigate the constraints and barriers of underserved populations. And with that, I'll leave and take questions if you have any. Any final questions, Josh?
So I think you came to sort of conclusions that fit with maybe a slight, maybe it's just another way of looking at it. But, we talked a little bit about mental models earlier, and, I think about a little bit about path dependency and, all the little quotes you pulled were really, they said some pretty awesome things about these experiences, but then no one's using Uber after the and,
there are some other issues with Uber.
Yeah, sure. But the framework that you were using to analyze everything, I think the one piece that I don't see in that is this idea of shared mental model, right? Mm-hmm. And you were talking about increasing visibility. Well, one of the things that, and I don't know, your participants may have been from different community areas, but I bet you got everyone together in a room and had them talking about their stories about Uber. That would all of a sudden familiarize people with Uber and maybe start to change, the shared mental model. So there's something about community awareness. You live in a city, you hear it all the time. Your friends are doing it. And so there's that other sort of thing. You might really like Uber, your experience with Uber, but you're going to be less inclined to use it if people around you aren't using it. So there's,
it's true, but there are also other barriers. Like, I have to have a credit card in order to join.
Sure, sure. Yeah, not
so it's hard to save. I understand what you're saying, but it's just like, and our participants did say, I talked to my friends, about it. But in terms of having the onboard, you know, someone to kind of handhold and see
right.
them through the process,
right.
that is, I think that needs to exist, which is another reason why we're looking at the nonprofits.
Yeah.
We're writing a proposal now, and in that proposal, we train the nonprofits, and the nonprofits will train their, you know, their clients on how to use it. But then again, there's still this payment model. So it's, we're also looking at other ride-sharing models. People know jitney cabs. They'll use that, but they also accept cash. But there's also, you know, some issues with that too. But is there a model where people could, you know, pay the nonprofit, you know, somehow and have the nonprofit fund? Or should it be better subsidies,
right?
I mean, so those are things to think about. But I really feel like that nonprofit organization can help to mitigate the trust issues and maybe help to reduce the barrier because of credit cards, possibly.
So I don't want to diminish some of these more practical issues. But I think there is a sort of, you know, word of mouth,
right.
common understanding,
right.
common knowledge. It's unfamiliar. I'm scared of it because it's unfamiliar. What is Uber? You know, there is no Uber,
right.
right? Well, when it becomes commonplace to talk about it, you know, jitney cabs, sure, they've got all kinds of issues, but because it's common, it's understood,
yeah.
it's okay to do it.
Yeah.
You know, how do I get from here to there? I'll put that cat, right?
The jitneys, too, have that alliance with the grocery store.
Yeah.
provider,
mm-hmm.
right? So, and you won't take the jitney unless you know
mm-hmm.
someone who's referring
mm-hmm.
it to you. So I feel like that's also critical in order for it to work. Like a jitney driver has to say, you know, how do I get more clients? It's almost like, who do I need to, you know, become friends with?
Right.
What organization and what grocery store do I need to become friends with in order to work? Cause Prince Valley Market is a grocery store in Southwest Detroit. They have the jitney cab drivers like posted on the billboards
yeah.
outside. They kind of have a residential jitney
yeah.
cab. Yeah. So that's my hunch in order for these systems to work in these communities. And we're going to pursue that a little bit more to
yeah.
see what happens.
I wonder if you can reflect on your sort of relationship with the participants, because in many ways you're sort of dealing with some of the things I deal with. I mean, you're in this highly privileged position, you have a job, you have a generous income, and you just sort of these one-off visits, leave, publish papers, or why do you go, you mentioned sharing things with the NGOs, but how do you share this information with the people you collect the data from?
Right, so the Focus Hope is an organization that contacted me when I was a postdoc, and at the time I didn't really they were looking at my dissertation research, which I moved away from. And so it kind of formed a relationship where, you know, I would talk to them about what I'm doing. And they would, let's say, at one point I was working a massive overnight courses as a means of employment. And so they contacted me to the librarian, who then asked questions about what kinds of courses could someone come in and take without having a college degree. And so I communicate with the librarians in that case, and they communicate with the public. So I haven't had direct face-to-face with the public yet, but I will say that my team, or we're going to another community partner, they've asked us to do like it's like bring your own device, kind of like an open lab for tech literacy. And so me and my students and I are going to go out and do that. So it's really through these organizations.
Yeah.
Like they're asking and then we respond. And then working with Tiffany Vino on this next proposal, I feel like she's taking it to another level where we have an advisory committee. This is like true community-based participatory research where they serve the advisory role and they really tell us what the communities, you know, are requiring. Maybe we can train, you know, we can share through them and they will share with
yeah.
the residents they work with. Yeah. That's a good question. I appreciate that question because that means a lot. To me. Another thing we try to do in these workshops is, so we see people exchanging phone numbers, but we also provided other platforms for employment. So we had, you know, sheets were just informative, providing our participants with information about, if you're interested in this, here's more, kind of thing.
Strangely, some of the barriers, like the payment barriers and things like that, are
I work at African similar issues, and a lot of the same barriers exist, and there they figured out ways of around the barriers. I'm just wondering if there's ways to learn from other places.
I invited myself to some assistants, and we still have an open item to come back to this. But yeah, you're absolutely right. I'm teaching a PhD seminar called Research Methods for Specialized Populations, where we're kind of looking at ICTD research and kind of asking these questions in our context as well. So I think that, yeah, that's definitely
something to guess. I wonder if some of the inhibition or the barriers to, like, the credit cards issue would be reduced if companies like Uber would be more open to, like, pay cash.
Mm-hmm.
The reason I bring this up is because they do this in other countries. Like,
I was going to say that. Like, I think this is one of the things that they're piloting in other countries,
India.
But they're not piloting. They're not.
They do this there. Yeah, I'm from India, and I was just there over break. And Uber does, Amazon does cash on delivery. Uber does cabs. You can, like, get after the end of your ride, you can just pay them by cash. And it's kind of the same thing. People are worried about putting their credit card information into the technology, like giving their credit card information to this unknown, unseen company, and it's basically just technology for them. We're like, we don't know. I've like tried to have my mother put her credit card information, even to sign up for an Apple iCloud account, and she's like, just don't do it. Like, and they allow you to sign up for an Apple account, like an iCloud account, without putting your credit card in India, and they allow you to have an Uber account without having credit card information. So there are these ways of, like, working around the system, which I guess that's, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's a question that I have, too. It's like, why is that? But there's the Prince Valley market that I talked about earlier. The owner, Joe Gaffney, he had this program where if his customers spent $50 or more in the grocery store, then he would provide them with a one-way ride back home. He's kind of been in a, you know, advisory committee, because he was also, you know, someone that we talked to earlier. But now, this is maybe after a year and a half, he's saying that the Uber drivers they're rude because they don't like the short trips. So if it's like within a 5-mile radius, and he basically said the customer service is terrible. And I think the time when I first met Joe, they didn't have a business account. Because I said, look, what you're doing is, like, not illegal. Well, it violates their rules, because you're calling a ride on the behalf of someone else. And then there were restrictions, because while someone was riding, they thought it was him, he couldn't initiate other rides.
Right.
So he would kind of bring in the jitney cabs as an alternative transportation route. It's like, well, the Uber driver's up, take this jitney, and you negotiate the price with the jitney cab. But he said if he saw where he was making enough money, he said he would buy his own vehicle to transport clients that needed rides. And one of the University of Michigan team, I've been advising this team called CAR, they have a program at Meijer where for $20, it's really $10 for the riders, but it's $20 that goes to Lyft, that you can bring up to 3 people in the ride, go to Meijer, and then they'll give you the $10 for your way back. And then they have kind of a coupon code scanning. It doesn't require a credit card, because they do the payment through the coupon codes. But you still have to have a smartphone and, like, digital, you know, you have to have a stable data plan. But and we're working with them. So we're exploring new models for leveraging these systems, as well as maybe a Zipcar. And the Focus Hope, the other nonprofit that I work with, said that Zipcar offered a Zipcar for them. They just dropped the car off and put news out saying, hey, Zipcar is available, sign up here, and no one used it. And then they just took the Zipcar away. But again, this is a case where I think people need to be onboarded and trained how to use it and really understand why these models don't work. So that's another direction that we're writing a proposal now to figure out what works, what would work. Because transportation is huge, not just for employment, but you know, access to healthy food, access to medical appointments, and the medical facilities lose money for no-shows, right? If you can't get, if you can't make an appointment, there's a lot of money that went into preparing for that appointment that you could save that. Right. So those are other, you know, areas.
Yeah, I mean, this is really fascinating. I have actually several questions. Let me, in the interest of time, just focus on one. So, have you thought about maybe other transportation solutions? I mean, what came to mind when you talk about Uber, why Uber, right, in a situation like this? Because that's
really,
economically, I don't even have to go through any calculations because it's too expensive, right?
Right.
If you make $8 an hour and it costs $16 to build the suburbs or something, more like. But what about something more like BlaBlaCar, right, where you pool actually people, right, and sort of one could actually, especially in connection with sort of some of the communities, right, you can sort of come up with an intermediate substance.
So we know that Uber Pool exists, it just doesn't exist in Detroit, and I think Uber Pool would be great, especially for like the, you know, nonprofits could, you know, help to organize these pools.
But I'm even thinking about something like, you know, the equivalent of zero rating for transportation, because if the clinic or the, you know, the different stakeholders actually have a loss because somebody doesn't show up.
Right.
But for them, it might actually make sense to help underwrite that shared kind of mode of transportation.
So we are working with this, a federally qualified health center that says that they have 30% no-shows for one clinic. And so they do want us to kind of help analyze this data to figure out, well, did they really miss the appointment because they didn't have a car or didn't have transportation, or was there another reason? So they've asked, you know, Michigan to provide some resources to help them figure out where these no-shows exist. The hunch is that they didn't have transportation, or they had transportation set up, but something fell through. And they didn't, you know. So that's kind of the next step, is really understanding where this comes from. But yeah, we are working with these stakeholders too.
And can I just ask a last broader question? I mean, I think what I see in your work, although you don't focus on it, but I mean, there's multiple barriers to really being employed at a level that you can sort of have a decent life.
Right.
And so. So you're sort of solving some necessary conditions of even taking part of it, right? But then having a job that pays enough is just a huge other challenge. All the questions with qualifications are needed. It almost seems like when we talk about technology, we also have to sort of think in those additional contexts, right? Unless our technological solutions are related to those institutional job market, then educational solutions, they will always be just sort of like
Right. So I mean that's true, and I have collaborations where we are trying to work on this. And in one case, Carnegie Mellon, and their learning team, they're looking at I guess they have their own tools. They're not massive open online courses, but they're like massive open online courses, and trying to understand what career pathways would look like, and what classes could you take in an online form. In order to find, I guess, a better paying job. But then I've learned in my earlier work that people don't learn independently. People who are taking these courses are highly motivated people, and maybe learning in a group setting would work better for this too. So, it does sound like there's like one there after another. Another thing we've considered is we know that in order for people to access better paying jobs, they have to have certain skills. So then the question is, what skills, how do you go about getting those skills? And then what are the opportunities available around you to get those skills? It's a long process, but these are other things that we're looking at. Is what are the types of jobs offered on TaskRabbit, or, you know, maybe even at a local nonprofit that people could do instead of, you know, not being able to do anything. So it's a hard problem. I am open to suggestions. If different approaches, I'm definitely open to. But we have started, you know, I have started collaborations with others to kind of get at the larger problem. But you don't really know if you're headed in the right direction.
Yeah. I think we have reached it. This is very interesting. So thank you very much.
Okay.
We have reached it.